Well, welcome to this evening's event, which is entitled The Politics of Exclusion Today. Before I hand the chair over to Dean Christine Rey, who will introduce Professor Daniel Ziblatt, I would like to say a few words about the general series we are hosting here at the Hertie School. It is entitled Understanding the Politics and Policies of Exclusion. It is meant to set the scene for an important study that we expect will be completed in about 2 years' time. In November 2020, the Hertie Foundation commissioned the Gesellschaft für Unternehmungsgeschichte to conduct a comprehensive study on the history of its assets. Dr. Johannes Beer and PD Dr. Ingo Köhler received this commission, and they will focus especially on the Nazi period, but also on what happened after World War II. The goal of the speaker series is, in a sense, to set the context. That is, in the following 2 years, we'll have one talk at the beginning of a semester, which provides more of a historical context of what happened. But of course, we are a policy school, and we care also about implications for today. And I'm delighted that today we have Daniel Ziblatt here, indeed, who will, in some sense, contemporize some of the themes that we have been talking about in his presentation. Now, I could say all sorts of great things about him, but that's the job of Dean Christine Rey. So I will now hand over the floor to Christina. Christina?
Thank you very much, Mark, and a very warm welcome, Daniel Ziblatt, at the Hertie School. So it is my great honor and pleasure to introduce today's keynote speaker, who probably needs a little introduction. Daniel Ziblatt divides his time between Boston and, I am delighted to say, Berlin. He is Eaton Professor of Government at Harvard University, and he leads, and he is the director, leads the Transformation of Democracy Group at the Science Center here in Berlin, the WZB. Professor Ziblatt has also been a visiting professor at the European University Institute at Stanford and at the Max Planck Institute in Cologne. Daniel Ziblatt is a leading scholar, a leading voice, really, on the history of democracy and the study of Europe. And his particular interests include questions of identity, questions of participation, polarization, and authoritarianism. Professor Ziblatt really is an extremely accomplished academic in his field. His publications span the top journals of political science. And his 2006 and 2017 monographs, Structuring the State and Conservative Parties and the Birth of Democracy, are highly acclaimed and award-winning. Among others, they received the 2018 Woodrow Wilson Award and the Barrington Moore Prize. Yet Professor Ziblatt is also a public intellectual, as you will hear in a moment. Together with Stephen Levitsky, he has written How Democracies Die, a New York Times and Spiegel bestseller that has been translated into 22 languages. Then I think few novels managed to muster such widespread interest and glory. In today's event, Professor Ziblatt will discuss how societies can change into exclusionary communities and how democratic institutions can respond when they come under siege. Dan, we look very much forward to your talk, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Christine, and also Mark. Thank you for the nice introduction, and thank you for the invitation to and the opportunity to participate in this important lecture series. And I understand the kind of context of the lecture series and this focus on the politics of exclusion, and so I'm really honored to be a part of this. The topics and the themes of the series, I think, are quite appropriate for what I wanted to talk about this evening. And I thought a good starting point is just to note that there seems to be widespread consensus in the West today that global democracy is under threat. Democratic backsliding seems to be rampant everywhere from Venezuela to Hungary to India. And suddenly, unexpectedly, I would say, some of the world's oldest democracies in Europe and North America face new challenges. So in this lecture, what I wanted to do was to zero in on the challenges that new exclusionary movements and political parties pose in European and North America's inclusive democracies. And I'm going to make what I think is a slightly counterintuitive argument that the roots of these challenges today, one key part of the roots of these in old democracies, comes from a surprising source. And that is that political establishments in democracies today are weakening. So in a sense, actually becoming more inclusive. which has, somewhat paradoxically, I would argue, opened the door to populist forces that may themselves actually threaten liberal democratic institutions. So I want to spell out this paradox and think about some of the consequences and implications of it. So just to start really at the top, I mean, we all know about the rise of illiberal political parties in established democracies, you know, which have begun to attack not only the norms of democracies, but in some cases, the very rules of liberal democracy. So Trump, Salvini, Le Pen, the Austrian Freedom Party, the Brexit Party, and of course, the AfD in Germany. This rise of illiberalism has gotten a lot of attention, of course, but the bulk of this attention, I would say, has tended to focus on what political scientists often call the demand side of this story. So in other words, why are voters turning to support these kinds of parties and politicians? Many scholars, when trying to understand this, focus on the economic causes of this shift of voters, and they highlight that established parties have failed to protect unskilled workers, for example, from the effects of globalization, disappearing jobs, stagnating incomes, rising inequality, especially in the wake of the 2008-2009 financial crisis. Other scholars have pointed to the role of race, immigration, culture, and how Americans and Europeans are responding to immigration and ethnic diversification. So in fact, Steve Levitsky and I made an argument a little bit along these lines in our book, How Democracies Die, where we argued that it's the reaction of previously dominant majority, primarily white and Christian and male to a large degree, to growing diversity and racial equality that's driving polarization in the United States and also leading to norm erosion. So a kind of sense of cultures under siege. Now these are the kind of standard things that people talk about when they think about the demand side, and they clearly are important. I wouldn't want to deny that. But I also think they don't tell the entire story. And I think if we really want to understand what's happening in our democracies today, it's also important to emphasize what we can think of as a supply side to the story. And that supply side story is that it's much easier today to be an electorally successful illiberal, populist, or authoritarian than it was in the 1950s, 60s, or 70s in Western Europe and the United States. And that is because political establishments are weakening across the globe. Now, you're going to immediately ask yourself, what is a political establishment? And that's a good question. And so let me just offer a definition, a rough definition. Political establishment is the kind of collection of organizations and actors that control the resources politicians need to get elected and to sustain a political career. So the resources and organizations. For the sake of simplicity, I think we can talk about three different types of establishment organizations. One is political parties, which are really important to politicians because they control access to candidacy for office. Another is business, labor, and other interest groups, which are really critical sources of finance and other campaign resources. And then finally, third is major media outlets, such as television stations and newspapers, which are the principal means through which politicians gain access to voters. So political parties, interest groups, media outlets, these obviously don't constitute a single monolith. There's considerable amount of pluralism. There always has been in democracies in North America and Western Europe, but they nonetheless pose certain boundaries, both in terms of political style and policy substance. Politicians who exceeded those boundaries, who violate certain behavioral norms or push extremist policies, tend to be shunned by the establishment. Party leaders won't nominate them, union leaders won't back them, and mainstream media won't cover them, or at least might be biased against them. Now, half a century ago, this mattered a lot because the political establishment really maintained almost something like a monopoly over the resources politicians needed to get elected. So in the 1950s, 60s, even into the early 1970s, party leaders controlled the candidate selection process. There were really no primaries for the selection of candidates in political parties in most democracies. A relatively small number of interest groups provided the bulk of finance and other campaign resources, so business groups, chambers of commerce, interest groups, labor unions, and then also a limited number of media outlets dominated the media scene. So the United States famously had three media outlets, Britain had one, Germany had a few. So this meant that any politician who was really serious about getting elected had to be on pretty good terms with the establishment. Politicians needed the approval of an established political party in order to run for office. They needed the approval of major interest groups so that they could raise money. And they needed to get the approval of major media outlets so that they could get decent coverage. Now, this dependence had really important consequences. It meant that politicians didn't respond directly only to voters and their preferences, but also responded to these organized groups, or what we can think of again as the establishment. They had to strike a balance between appealing to voters and appealing to these other groups. This had a powerful restraining effect. It basically meant that really only insiders, or at least candidates who kind of aligned with these pro-establishment groups, could establish a successful political career. This was, in some sense, not entirely inclusive and democratic, but it was pretty stable. And it was really the heart of 20th century Western democracy, a system in which political competition was genuine, it was real, but it was nonetheless constrained to some degree by politicians' dependence on the establishment. Politicians who challenged the establishment, the ones that we often today, of course, call populists, usually failed. This establishment monopoly really existed in most democracies across the world, the United States, the United Kingdom, Germany, Sweden, and so on. Now, over the last few decades, establishments across the world have begun losing their monopoly over electoral resources, which means they are losing their power over politicians. In many democracies, established parties have lost their monopoly, for example, over candidacies, thanks to a process of internal party democratization, so the introduction of primaries. So just consider for a moment the United States, where this happened quite early. Historically, in the United States, American political parties did a pretty good job of gatekeeping. They maintained, as an establishment, a monopoly on selecting candidates, especially for president, for the office of the president. Now, this is really important to remember because the United States has had no shortage of extremist potential demagogues. So in the 1930s, Catholic priest Father Coughlin was a right-wing radio personality who had tens of millions of listeners. He was a kind of precursor to today's Fox News in some ways. It's incredibly popular. In the 1920s, Henry Ford, the founder of Ford Motor Company, was a rabid anti-Semite. And he seriously considered running for president. And there were these kind of straw polls done in which he had lots of support. In the 1930s, Huey Long was an autocratic governor from Louisiana. He also had presidential ambitions, very popular. In the 1950s, Joseph McCarthy, the red-baiting senator from Wisconsin, George Wallace in the 1960s, the segregationist governor from Alabama, again, very popular. And indeed, there's Gallup poll data going back to the 1930s, which shows that each of these figures earned around 30-35% approval ratings, which really isn't so far actually from basically the modal approval rating of Donald Trump even during his presidency. Now, what's important though is that none of these figures that I've just mentioned, despite being very popular, ever made it close to the presidency, except for Donald Trump. So the question is, how were they kept out? And I would argue that part of the reason they were kept out was through this relatively exclusive presidential candidate selection process. Prior to 1972 is the really turning point here. Prior to 1972, American presidential candidates were selected by party leaders during conventions in what's often described as smoke-filled back rooms. The system was not transparent, it wasn't inclusive or particularly democratic, but it was an incredibly effective filtration system. Party leaders served as gatekeepers. They engaged in actually what political scientists at the time liked to call peer review. And what they meant by that was that party leaders who worked closely with potential candidates, knew these candidates' weaknesses, knew their strengths, knew who might be demagogues, they kept them out if they feared them. And so despite all of the shortcomings, the system, I wouldn't argue that we go back to the system before 1972, this system worked pretty well in keeping demagogues out. So under this system was basically impossible for an outsider like Henry Ford or a demagogue like Huey Long to even be nominated by a major party. So most of these figures didn't even try. Now, what happened in 2016 in the United States is that American parties had adopted a system of binding primaries beginning in 1972. Now, the system after 1972, where voters select the candidates for the parties, was far more open, far more transparent, in some sense more democratic than the old convention system. That also weakened party leaders' role as gatekeepers. It weakened the political establishment. So now if a demagogue like Henry Ford ran for office, it would be much harder to keep him out. And that's really what we saw in 2016. Donald Trump was, in a sense, the Henry Ford of his day. Henry Ford had wanted to be president, as I said. He had a lot of support, considered running. But whereas party gatekeepers kept Ford far from the presidency, Trump found the gates wide open. In the United Kingdom, a similar story could be told about how candidates are selected. Gatekeeping power now lies much more in the hands of activists, especially in the Labour Party after recent reforms. Party members and activists have much more influence than ever before. And even in Germany, this is the case. The SPD, which was the political party that generated this model, the famous sociologist Robert Michels had this notion of the iron law of oligarchy, that any party, even if it's democratic, is always going to be run by its leaders. Even that party now allowed its party activists to pick the party leaders directly last year. So we've witnessed really a kind of similar confrontation, even just in this Germany CDU, a kind of notoriously hierarchical party just the last several weeks, where you had this kind of self-declared candidate of the Basis, Markus Söder. He did lose out. So in some sense, the party establishment remained intact. But even the CDU, I think, shows signs with this kind of overt conflict of a party establishment that's weakening. So the weakening of the party establishment, that's one big development. A second big development, though, is in the realm of interest groups. Interest groups have also lost their monopoly over campaign finance, because candidates can now raise money on the internet, for example. In the United States, this has gone the most extreme form. I mean, I like to think of this example often. If you consider this, back in 2016, Bernie Sanders, who was the ultimate outsider, Bernie Sanders raised as much money as Hillary Clinton, the consummate insider, in the 2016 Democratic nomination fight. So outsiders can rely on decentralized sources of money, reducing the exclusive power of interest groups. And then the third big development, in addition to parties and interest groups, as I said, is in the realm of media and the emergence of social media, which has eroded the influence of the established media. So today, Twitter, Facebook, and other social media outlets allow candidates to reach voters, even if they are shunned by the mainstream media. So my co-author, Steve Levitsky, visited Brazil at the beginning of that country's 2018 presidential election campaign. He met with a bunch of business leaders, most of whom had backed the established center-right candidate. Now, even though that candidate was down in the polls, the business leaders he was meeting with were really convinced he would win. The establishment candidate would win because he was backed by a broad coalition of mainstream parties, which, following Brazil's election law, gave him a huge advantage in allocated TV time. So he had more than an hour of free TV time every night, whereas the right-wing candidate, Bolsonaro, had less than a minute. So nobody that he talked to in Sao Paulo mentioned WhatsApp. Nobody mentioned YouTube. But it turned out Bolsonaro used WhatsApp and YouTube to bypass entirely the TV networks, and he won the election. I think similarly, we can see in Germany today, the radical right AFD doesn't really need mainstream media institutions. A reporter that I was talking to last year for a German magazine, national magazine, said to me that AFD politicians don't do interviews with them anymore. She said, they don't need us. And indeed, they've had their own YouTube channel that uses that to communicate directly with their voters. They dominate social media. A recent study that I saw looked at the 2019 European parliamentary elections, found that of the hundreds of millions of Facebook interactions about politics, 85% of them are connected to pages with the AFD. At least this was in 2019. You know, things may be changing now. But the point is, the radical right, up until pretty recently, has dominated social media in Germany. The establishment parties were totally absent. So again, the outsider is reaching voters outside of traditional media channels. So in sum, what I think all of this means is that politicians today don't need the establishment as much as they used to. They can raise money online, they can reach voters via Twitter, via Facebook, and all the other social media outlets, and they can hijack political parties through primaries, as Trump did in the United States, or in multi-party systems, they can create their own parties, like the Five Star Movement in Italy, or the AFD in Germany. So in a certain way, for an outsider politician, or a potential outsider politician, this is extremely liberating. Freed of their dependence, or their need to be dependent on the establishment, ambitious outsiders can respond to what they think voters want directly without worrying about what the elite thinks. And in fact, they can campaign against the elite and make that central to what they're doing. Now, in the wake of the financial crisis, the context of rising inequality, heightened racial and cultural resentments, not to mention the rise of COVID and all of the politics surrounding this, there's a fair amount of public demand for such populist appeals. But the point I would make is that there's always been demand for these kinds of populist appeals among Western electorates. Again, remember what I said about Henry Ford or Father Coughlin. There's been millions of people who've backed these sort of people in the past. What's new is what's happening on the supply side. It's much easier today to bypass the establishment and even oppose the establishment than it was 50 years ago. Now, in thinking about the themes of inclusion and exclusion, this scenario is in some way more inclusive in this particular way than the old one. I mean, thanks to their newfound independence from the establishment, politicians can be more responsive to voters. They can give voters at least what they think what voters want. And this, though, is then the paradox, is that this leaves us and our democracies more vulnerable to demagogues, more vulnerable to politicians who engage in a politics of exclusion, many of who go on to assault democratic political institutions. So this really is quite a paradox, I would say. You know, Western elites used to hate democracy. You know, think back to the 18th and 19th century, economic and political elites were terrified of democracy and they equate it with majority rule and rule by the great unwashed masses. Western elites really didn't accept democracy until the late 19th, early 20th centuries. And what made democracy acceptable to them in part were counter-majoritarian institutions, in part representative democracy. But another thing that made modern democracy safe for elites was the power of political establishments. Things like hierarchical party organization, powerful interest groups, and a media that provided certain guardrails to our politics. The 19th and 20th century establishments imposed powerful constraints on political competition, transforming what might have been a highly plebiscitary or majoritarian politics into more bounded competition. This gave birth to what we can think of, thinking of Joseph Schumpeter, the great economist, as Schumpeterian democracy. Schumpeter's definition of democracy was a system essentially of elite competition. In this sense, 20th century democracy, although being certainly more inclusive than Schumpeter ever imagined, was Schumpeterian. And this Schumpeterian democracy depended on a powerful establishment. But I would argue that those days have been coming to an end and the establishment's gatekeeping powers have begun to erode. And again, this is in some sense more inclusive, more democratizing, but it also means that it opens the door to demagogues. Trump, Salvini, Bolsonaro, many of who go on to attack these institutions. So we can think of this as a kind of boomerang effect. There's a kind of unintended effect of this transformation of our politics. And so the question that I want to deal with now is to think about how do we get ourselves out of this bind? Because if one's committed to the values and principles of liberal democracy, one needs to be nervous of this kind of exclusionary politics. But at the same time, our politics are becoming more open. And since our democracies are premised on the notions of inclusion, tolerance, you know, must we also tolerate and include forces of exclusion and intolerance? I mean, this is really a hard dilemma. The good news, though, I think, is that we don't actually need to reinvent the wheel entirely. We are not really the first generation to confront the rise of parties and politicians that assault democracy from within. One can think of the interwar years in Europe, certainly. The scale of the threat may be different in some places and different times, but the essential dilemma then, as well as now, remains the same. If one party subverts the rules of the game, what is the proper response? History, and I think the experience of countries around the world, suggest three broad types of answers, and I wanted to go through each of these answers. The first answer for dealing with this dilemma of how do you deal with these exclusive, intolerant forces in an inclusive democracy comes from the darkest days of Europe's democratic history in the 1930s. So the method that emerged out of that period is the idea of forging a left-right front of containment. This is a strategy that was made explicit in the important work of the Spanish political scientist Juan Linz. Linz, who was born in Weimar, Germany, but grew up in Spain during the Civil War, Spanish Civil War in the 30s, spent his career at Yale University studying the breakdown of democratic regimes. One of his central points on this notion of a kind of common front or containment strategy was that politicians, first of all, need to be able to identify what types of political parties and actors are threats to democracy. So in his 1978 book, Breakdown of Democratic Regimes, he proposes something he calls a litmus test. And Levitsky and I borrowed from this in our own book. And he basically argues that if a politician or party, before they get into power, attacks the constitutional order, verbally even, condones violence, attacks the legitimacy of rivals, regularly assaults basic civil liberties like the media, then alarm bells should go off for democratic citizens. And Linz argues what is necessary in that situation is a containment strategy. One that requires that all democratic forces, left and right, people who disagree maybe vehemently and passionately on policy, join together to isolate extremist or anti-democratic forces. So one example is interwar Britain in the 20s and 30s, where national governments that included both Labour and Tory led the country through the Great Depression. This was formed in part to deal with the Great Depression, but it also had the effect of ensuring that Oswald Mosley's Union of Fascists made few inroads into the British political system. Other similar experiments include Belgium in the 1930s, when socialists and conservative Catholic parties, who really disagreed on a lot, personally didn't like each other very much, nonetheless in the 1930s, joined together to isolate the kind of Belgian Nazi right-wing extremist parties. The decision of some never-Trump Republicans, so-called never-Trump Republicans, to work together with Democratic-leaning activist groups and support even Joe Biden in the 2020 election also reflects a similar strategy of containment. A second strategy for coping with authoritarians within a democracy emerged in the post-1945 period, especially in West German, German democracy. And this is the notion of defensive democracy or militant democracy, Streitbare Demokratie, Wehrhafte Demokratie. And the basic notion, of course, here developed by Karl Lowenstein, a German emigre political scientist who came to the United States in the 1930s from Germany, who was incredibly frustrated and decried the passivity of German liberals in the face of the Nazi takeover. And so in his view, it was a dramatic mistake to allow fascists to fester in a political system, even with a strategy of containment, because they could then use that system to come to power. And the quote that haunted advocates of militant democracy, people like Lowenstein, was one quote in particular comes from Joseph Goebbels himself, who infamously said after the Nazis were already in power, and this is from Goebbels, he said, "This will always remain one of the best jokes of democracy, that it gave its deadly enemies the very means by which it was destroyed." So in the minds of post-war German jurists and thinkers, the notion of allowing actors like this to gain access to the political system was unacceptable. And so they embraced this notion of militant democracy, and it was incorporated into the German constitution itself. And several articles of the constitution allow the state and the legal system to differentiate between acceptable and unacceptable speech and debate, as well as acceptable and unacceptable political parties. And then once after a legal process is undertaken to ultimately empower the state to ban dangerous or unacceptable political parties or debate that threaten the constitution. This doctrine is used in the 1950s to ban the Communist Party, Nazi-like party, and of course it remains relevant today in Germany's constitution and its dealings with the AfD. Now this model has been adopted to varying degrees by other European democracies. It's even come up increasingly in the United States as well. People, at least at kind of in academic conferences and so on, saying such a strategy could be used to crack down on some right-wing militia groups associated with the Republican Party, including those linked to the January 6th assault on the US Capitol. So these two strategies of containment and outright exclusion are powerful strategies that have a lot to say for themselves, but they also have some limitations. Containment is really the kind of Lindsayan strategy from the interwar years is a short-term emergency strategy, not a long-term solution. And it's especially difficult in a two-party system to form these big coalitions because in a two-party system, it's hard to know who's competing then if all the parties join together. Makes multi-party coalitions almost unthinkable. And even in multi-party systems, the notion of a kind of grand coalition, although it obviously has legitimacy in the post-war context, over the long run, there's a sense in which this potentially weakens the legitimacy of a political system. So that's the kind of weaknesses of a containment strategy. Similarly, the militant democracy strategy, while appealing in emergency settings, is a strategy that over the long run, it also poses real legitimacy problems. It's first of all, not particularly easy to ban parties and it's politically difficult. In fact, you know, in Germany only in the 1950s did this get carried out. And so it fits, although albeit even uneasily, even in the German constitutional setting, there's a lot of people who are critical of it. It's sort of a weapon that's so large, it's hard to use. And in settings like the United States, where a kind of much more self-conceived liberal constitutional setting, it's even more difficult to make the case that political parties should be banned and speech should be banned. So this also has a kind of, it's not clear this is a model that travels everywhere in the world. So then I wanted to talk now finally about a third strategy. And this is the one, this strategy as well has strengths and weaknesses. It's the one that Americans have traditionally opted for when facing this dilemma of how to deal with exclusive forces within a democracy. So since James Madison, certainly since John Stuart Mill, liberal political doctrine, which has infused American thinking, has been premised on the idea that competition is the great elixir. So not containment, not exclusion, but competition. So facing illiberalism, John Stuart Mill would advise, let all opinions compete. On this account, it's a mistake to use the physical force of the state to silence outrageous voices. because it's only by hearing outrageous voices that we learn to defeat them. And so the solution to Mill was what he called the collision of adverse opinions. Let all ideas compete. And this notion of competition underpins how many Americans view our own democracy as a great self-correcting political machine. Competition moderates. This is especially so, political science teaches us, in a two-party system. Because in a two-party political system like the United States, in theory, if a party veers off course, it should be punished at the ballot box. So in this view, electoral competition is a natural corrective for political extremism and intolerance. Parties that stray too far from average voters lose votes, which compels them to moderate and broaden their appeal to win again. So like a professional sports team, you lose, you fire the coach, you acquire new players, you come up with a new strategy. The same should hold for political parties. And indeed, if you ask most never Trump Republicans today who are frustrated with their own political party and the radicalizing tendencies of the American Republican Party, what will get the Republican Party back on course, they almost invariably say, what we need is devastating electoral defeat. So this may be right. I mean, I think there's a certain logic to the Millian approach, but there's a hitch, there's a problem with this approach as well. And that is that competition may be undermined by exclusion. So in waiting for the magic of competition to kick in, it's possible that electoral authoritarians in the meantime can assault democratic institutions, making democratic institutions dysfunctional, toothless, so that the self-correcting logic of democracy doesn't work quickly enough. My own greatest fear about American democracy is exactly this. The Republican Party in states that it dominates today is in the process, today as we speak, of altering voting rules, making them more exclusive, in effect disenfranchising African-Americans and other minorities, defanging the self-correcting mechanisms of democracy. Because if politicians can increasingly win power without winning a majority of citizens' support, then this kind of key link of accountability breaks. Democracy short circuits, and it becomes harder and harder to remove incumbents from power. It becomes harder and harder for oppositions to win. This is what has happened in Hungary over the past 7 years, and this is one of my greatest concerns about what could happen in the United States if Republicans in their current form regain power. So I'll conclude then just by saying, you know, I think it's pretty clear we live in an age of declining political establishments. These dynamics of what we might call inclusion, however, have paradoxically allowed for the entry of groups and politicians into power who assault democratic institutions, who pursue the politics of exclusion. The result is that I think we face a set of dilemmas with few easy and obvious answers. I've laid out three solutions: containment, exclusion, competition. Each is imperfect in its own way. So I think an important agenda moving ahead is to figure out how we remain committed to the virtues of inclusive democracy while preventing the forces of illiberalism from sabotaging democracy from within. So for scholars, there's certainly a lot to study. And for practitioners, there's a lot to do. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dan, for a thought-provoking talk. I'm sure there are probably lots of questions. We've got one in the chat already, but let me briefly remind you of the rules of the game. You can raise your hand, which you find at the bottom of your screens. You cannot turn on your cameras, but you can unmute yourself to ask a question, or you can use the Q&A function. Whilst our audience is looking for their first question, one has already come in, which I would like to put to you. This is by Nuria Köchling, who is engaging in a thought game, and asks about what would happen to the possibility of communicating freely if social media companies started charging money in order to use them, and what positive and negative outcomes could that have? I see no other hand, so I shall let you answer that first, please.
Yeah, I think that's an interesting idea, and I think the broader point that it raises is that, you know, we live in an era in which the old rules have in many cases broken down, obviously not everywhere, I don't want to overstate it. And one of the things about democracy, I think, that we learned, especially from the earlier era with the rise of television and radio technologies in the beginning of the 20th century, in the middle of the 20th century, is that rather than just assuming that democracy means fewer rules, I think we need to think of democracy, that the more inclusive democracy becomes, the more rules we may need. And so there's an analog, I think, in a way to markets as well. I mean, I think there's a bit of a myth that, you know, freer markets means fewer rules. I think it turns out in order for markets to work, I think, you know, economists and political economists have really come to realize, no, we need more rules, freer markets, more rules. And I think, and similarly in the realm of our political systems, the democracies aren't self-correcting systems, that they need rules and regulations to govern them. And so one area where this is clearly the case, I think, is in the realm of social media. And so the notion that we can just sort of have a free-for-all and that this will lead to kind of more inclusive democracy is belied by the fact that, of course, you get, you know, that we do get the intersection of economics here and market power, and you get monopolies and, you know, near monopolies. And what looks to be inclusive becomes very quickly not very inclusive, and distorting of free debate and so on. And so I think things like this idea are exactly the kinds of things that we should be thinking about. You know, and other ideas, I mean, certainly, you know, I've been teaching now at Harvard since 2003, and I think, and I've been teaching a variant of a course called Is Democracy Possible Everywhere? And, you know, at one point in the mid 2000s, you know, we were talking about Facebook and so on, right? You know, Facebook started at Harvard, and I kind of remember at some point raising the question, well, should Facebook be nationalized? And, you know, this was utterly shocking to students in, let's say, 2008. But by the time we get to 2020, I mean, none of my students use Facebook because they're so disgusted with it. And when I say they propose Facebook should be nationalized. And so I think the idea that, you know, that we have had changing set of expectations and ideas about, you know, whether these should be, and we're in many ways replaying the debates of the early 20th century in the United States, where there was this debate, you know, should industry be nationalized or should it be regulated? And, you know, or should antitrust policy be used? And these kinds of debates, I think, are once again relevant. For especially in the realm of social media, but I think also in the realm of voting, you know, we need to think about ways of assuring that voting is protected, the rights of voters are protected in the United States. This is obviously also another major issue.
Thank you. So the argument that you need to preserve the preconditions for democracy through, in a sense, rules, which, yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Nuria, for the question. Do we have other questions from the audience, either in speaking or in writing? Anyone else?
I see a question in the Q&A.
Yes, there is. So among the, I read it for everyone, among the three strategies of containment, exclusion, and competition, which one would be the most effective in a country like India, where cronyism along with misinformation seems to leave the opposition disempowered? Thank you, Deepesh.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's hard to imagine a strategy at this point. I mean, one of the challenges certainly in India right now is that the party in power is, this is a case of a party that was initially kind of an outsider party gaining power and assaulting, in many cases, the rights of minorities and cultural minorities in particular. And, you know, one of the things the opposition needs to do is to be able to win. I mean, that's sort of, you know, until the opposition can win, then a country is in a bind. And that's, you know, thinking about the United States, one of the things that, you know, is as pessimistic as I often am about American democracy, the fact that the Democrats could control the House of Representatives and could retake the presidency showed me that this is contingent on having a very strong and well-organized and well-financed opposition, which in other countries hasn't always been the case. And so this is a big difference between the United States, let's say, and Hungary, where it's been much harder for the opposition to win and to organize it, Turkey as well. And so I think the question for India is, will the opposition figure out a way of winning? And then once it does, I think then exactly these questions that the questioner asks become relevant. My sense is that, some mix of these strategies make sense. I mean, they all have their strengths and weaknesses. I think in a kind of emergency moment where democracy is existentially threatened, then the containment strategy makes a lot of sense. If you can convince groups to disagree with, who disagree with each other and don't like each other, to cooperate, then this can be incredibly powerful. And I think the evidence from Linz is very clear on this. I think this helped a great deal in the 2020 election in the United States. I think there's some movement of this, of kind of having a more united opposition in Hungary today. And I, you know, that's very broad. I mean, going from former neo-Nazis to, you know, socialists, you know, and this has its own problems and so on. But I think this is what may be necessary in a case like India as well, that the opposition overlook its divisions. And the problem with this is that, I'm a political scientist, so I understand that politicians are power seekers. And so to compromise with people you disagree with is very difficult. And it requires having a kind of longer time horizon. And it's easier to have that longer, two points about what makes it easier to have politicians to have this longer time horizon. Number one, that they understand what's happened in other countries and that it's often been necessary. And so that's part of the reason I wrote this book, How Democracies Die, is to kind of tell the stories of where this has worked out and when it hasn't worked out. But the second point is that, you know, as the threat becomes more existentially real for the health of a democracy, I think people begin to overlook their smaller differences. And so, you know, there were a lot of Republicans who in 2016 didn't quite understand the scale of the threat, although in my mind it was obvious. And so essentially just went along. By the time you got to 2020, a lot more Republicans had jumped ship and were willing to endorse the Democratic candidate, which is something that nobody in 2016 would have been willing to do.
Thank you very much. Are there other questions from the audience, from inside the school? As we're waiting for questions, Jen, please. Jen, would you like to turn your mic on?
Yes.
Now we can hear you.
I think you can hear me now. In your book, you mentioned two, and I'm gonna mispronounce or not say the right wording that you use, but you essentially talk about political trust between parties and between politicians. And what struck me is, particularly towards the end, you talk about how, this seeing the other side less as an enemy, but more like an adversary who, well, although you disagree, ultimately you're all fighting for, or you're all in the same boat for the common good. Let's put it that way. How do you go about rebuilding that kind of trust between political opponents and between politicians, particularly now that we've gotten down this road of a very adversarial tone in political debate? It's not so much, you know, I'm right and you're wrong, but really I'm right and you need to go to jail, or you are corrupt, and some really scathing, libelous accusations against political opponents.
Yeah, thank you for the question. Yeah, so the phrase, the word we use, I think it's what you described is very important, and I think it's right. The phrase we use to describe this is the norm, the unwritten rule of mutual toleration.
Mutual toleration, that's it.
Yeah,
sorry.
Right, where you accept. So it doesn't necessarily require trust, but at least it requires tolerating the other side, as you say, as a rival, not as an enemy.
Yeah.
And it's mutual in that it's reciprocal. One interesting thing about this norm of mutual toleration is that it's obviously not written down anywhere in any constitution, but it's an unwritten rule that doesn't automatically come to politicians and political leaders and even citizens. You know, and there's a wonderful book on the rise of written by Richard Hofstadter, on the rise of the norm of legitimate opposition, which is a similar kind of notion in the early 18th century in the United States, where, you know, it makes sense that if you think you know what's right, why would you ever listen to somebody? You know, if you think that you know what the right tax rate is, why would you ever listen to anybody else's conception of what the right tax rate is? And if you can do, if you can stay in power forever, why wouldn't you do that? And so this idea that, you know, we may not have a monopoly on the truth and that our rivals may actually have something to say, even if you think they're wrong, you know, there's enough doubt in your own mind that you allow the other side to win. And you know that in the end, it's better for the political system if each side has a chance to govern. And you let your other, you know, it, essentially the norm is you treat your others as rivals, not as enemies. And if they beat you, you allow them to govern. Now, to what degree you have to, what you privately feel is sort of a different question. At some level, then a norm is about public displays. You know, it's a, you know, you sort of, you know, I once remember somebody just defining the norm of tolerance as publicly accepting what you privately despise. And that may be, you know, that's a pretty thin, weak definition of the norm of toleration, but it may be, it's better than publicly not accepting the other side, right? So even that, a minimal kind of thing is hard, very hard to construct, as you say, and even harder once it's weakened to rebuild. And so that's your question, is how does one rebuild it? And I think one important, and this is really, you know, certainly a major question facing all of our democracies, as norms and unwritten rules change and kind of unacceptable behavior becomes normalized, how do you kind of put the genie back in the bottle? And I guess there's two points I would make about this. Number one, that what drives this is often fear of the other side. Fear of that if the other side wins, not only do you maybe not stand a chance of getting back into power, but that the other side's going to do things to you and the people, your constituencies, that are existentially damaging. And so, you know, as this fear heightens, then this norm deteriorates, the norm of mutual toleration deteriorates. So one thing is to kind of reduce the fear, right? But that, you know, that's often hard to do because in some sense, it's hard to understand what's driving the fear. I think often it feels like it's irrational, or it feels like, you know, to give up, you know, one of the wrong ways of dealing with this, I think, is comes from the example of the United States after the end of the Civil War, in which you had, and during the period of Reconstruction, Southern Democrats were very fearful of Republican government in the South because you had majority Black populations in many states in the South. And so the way to restore mutual toleration, often in American history, is to simply draw back democracy and to reduce the threat, in a sense. And I think that actually is a mistake, because in a sense, what you're doing is you're buying mutual toleration at the price of democracy. And that's the tragic choice that's been made throughout American history. So I think the challenge is, how do you sustain democracy, a multi-ethnic democracy, while at the same time maintaining this norm of mutual toleration? And I think a major role, you know, so I have no silver bullet answer. I have a long answer because I don't have a silver bullet answer to this. But one thing I would say is that I think the empirical evidence, and political scientists and others are doing, psychologists are doing research on this, that I think political elites have much more power than people kind of realize. And in some ways, the cues sent by politicians can be really important. Now, politicians are often afraid of their base. You know, they do what they think their base wants. But I think there are sort of key moments, decisive moments, highly public moments, where politicians can say certain things that try to alter norms. And so that's maybe a hopeful view. And I think this is something we need to study more into how to do this. But like, just to give you an example, I mean, one famous example that lots of people, you maybe you've even seen before, I think it was, you know, as John McCain lost the presidential, or maybe it may have been during a campaign event when he was running for president against Barack Obama, somebody in the audience asked him, you know, I think Barack Obama is a Muslim, that's why I'm not voting for him. And John McCain immediately kind of stepped back and said, no, that's not right. He's not Muslim. And, you know, to kind of combat this kind of misinformation. Now, you know, is that effective? You know, McCain did lose, right? But I don't think it was due to that. I mean, my sense is that at the very least, this is what politicians need to do, and that this is a step in the right direction. But I think the thing to not do, and I guess that's maybe my most concrete answer to you, is to give up on democracy. Give up a multi-ethnic democracy in order to retain the norm of mutual toleration. That's a mistake.
And thank you very much. Thank you, Jen. We've got three questions, one on supranational institutions, one on the paradox of inclusiveness, and one on the electoral integrity bill in the UK. So let's start with supranational institutions like the EU. What role can they play and advancing containment of an establishment, mostly political parties, specified in the member states? That's a question reaching us from Rafael Palomino.
Yes, so, you know, I think, again, I mean, you know, in politics, I mean, I've become more and more convinced often that, you know, the sort of principle of do no harm is often almost as important as, you know, what good can you do? Because I think one thing that's been pretty clear is that the EU, in this very paradoxical way, although it's a community of democracies, has in many ways bolstered up, until quite recently, essentially this single party rule in Hungary. And, you know, as much as the CDU and Angela Merkel and Christian democratic parties in Europe are pro-democratic and, you know, have tried to have a hard line against extremism within their own boundaries, the kind of very logic of supranational institutions makes this much more difficult to do in a supranational setting. And so the alliance between the Viktor Orban's Fidesz party and the Christian democratic parties in the European Parliament, and the reliance of the EPP, the group of parties that represent that come together out of the Christian democratic parties in the European Parliament, the reliance of these parties on the electoral success of Fidesz to help build up their majority in the parliament has made it easier to over, I mean, I'll put it this way, it's made it easier to overlook the democratic violations. And, you know, and so I've done some interviews on this, and you talk to politicians, and they'll often have this kind of rhetoric, including German, you know, members of the CDU will say, well, look at this, is, I understand that what he's doing isn't great. And this has now changed in recent years because of this, this has now been severed, the relationship between Fidesz and the EPP. But, you know, until recently anyway, you know, they would say, well, you know, this is not a great thing, we understand, but if we don't work with them, you know, they may, if we take too hard of a line against them, they'll maybe turn towards Russia. And there's all of this kind of rationalization that takes place that sounds very familiar to my ears, because this is often the same thing that you'll hear Republicans say about why they had to support Donald Trump, Republican politicians. Well, if we leave, then you know, things will get out of control. We have this really important role of responsibility to play. And so there's a way in which this self-justification, I think, is often a sign that something's wrong, right? And so I think what's happened until recently is that by allowing money to essentially flow to Hungary and turning a blind eye to democratic violations, this has actually, and the kind of half-baked nature of European political parties, this has made it much harder for even people who, even European Christian Democrats who don't like what Viktor Orban is doing, much harder to sort of have a hard line against him. And so, you know, I think in a funny way, I have a friend and colleague, Dan Kellerman, who says that half-baked lava cake is really delicious. Half-baked chicken sandwiches are very poisonous. And similarly, half-baked supranational institutions can be poisonous in the sense that you have political parties that are kind of like parties, but not actually, don't have the authority of a real political parties like the European EPP in the parliament. This allows for this kind of poisonous development to happen. So I think, you know, to my mind, one of the things that, and so, you know, the fact that the EU is simultaneously an international institution and in some way kind of like a domestic democratic institutions or has ambitions of doing this means that you kind of get this awkward situation where parties like this can emerge and there's no leverage over them. And there's kind of diplomatic logic among heads of state trumps the kind of normal logic of a democratic politics. So that's why it's easier to take a hard line against the AfD in Germany than it is to take a hard line against Viktor Orban, because in that case, you have a kind of diplomatic logic at work. And so I guess that what this suggests is that, you know, another argument for further European integration is to allow for real democratic competition, which would give Democrats within Europe kind of more tools to kind of squeeze out more authoritarian elements.
Thank you very much for your reply. I should add that we had Dan Kellerman this afternoon with us giving Europe lecture. Yes. I don't know how many of our audience were there this afternoon already, but of course he made that very argument. Wonderful. We have one question on the paradox of inclusiveness. So the argument reads that societies may have become more inclusive overall, but non-inclusive institutions persist. So would that not be an additional strategy for changing non-inclusive institutions?
Could it be some become, wait, so let me see, could it be that while I'm looking at the question, I'm sorry, while some societies become more inclusive, this would open the scope for much. So yeah, I guess it would be easier if I knew exactly what the questioner, which institutions the questioner had in mind. But you know, one argument that's often made is that what's made democracy stable, majoritarian democracy stable, is the presence of counter-majoritarian institutions. And so that would mean, you know, like historically the British House of Lords, let's say the US Senate, where only two states, or each state has two representatives no matter how large the state is. And in some sense, I would say those institutions are less, upper chambers tend to be less inclusive. And there's some way in which I think the question is right, that democracy was one of the things that made democracy acceptable to elites in the late 19th century was the presence of these counter-majoritarian institutions. The US Constitution itself was filled with these things to protect slave interests, to make it so, you know, the fear was that slave holders would jump ship and not join the Union. And so, you know, sort of certain carve-outs were allowed, these non-inclusive institutions were included in the bargain. And so, you know, there's something to that. I guess one concern I have about those kinds of institutions is that I think we shouldn't be under any illusions. These kinds of institutions are less democratic. They may be the price that needs to be paid in order to build any kind of democracy. But I think at the end of the day, you know, we have to recognize that they are not particularly democratic, and they tend to become the target of legitimacy crises. So you can think in Chile, after the transition in Chile after Pinochet, military was given sort of these specific zones of autonomy, and that's now come under attack. Spanish transition was a kind of pacted transition in the late 1970s, early 1980s. And a lot of the assault from the populist left and the populist right is in some sense that this was not really a fully democratic transition. And so these institutions later become a target. So it's worth noting that. And just a second point I would say is that when I think these non-inclusive institutions are particularly dangerous is when unintentionally often they become the purview of one political party. So in other words, if one political party disproportionately benefits from these non-inclusive institutions, then this is very dangerous because you then have a political party who's essentially sheltered by non-democratic institutions, kind of hunkers down behind those institutions and resists any change of them. And I think, by the way, that's what's happened to some degree in the United States today, is that the Republican Party, by no kind of design of their own, because they have, you know, in general, we know rural areas are overrepresented in the United States Constitution. But traditionally there was Democratic and Republican rural areas, but increasingly rural areas are disproportionately more Republican than Democratic. And so what this means is that Republicans systematically benefit from non-inclusive institutions. So this means the playing field is systematically biased against one political party. And if we have one party that systematically receives the benefits of non-inclusive institutions, this is a big problem for legitimacy and for democracy.
Thank you very much. And we've got one final question, which is about the Electoral Integrity Bill announced today in the UK and requiring photo ID to be shown when voting. Of course, a question familiar from the US, how do you see it, voter suppression or protection of democracy?
Yeah, so I don't know much about the voter ID law in Britain, but it's a really interesting question because, you know, in the US, the US is quite an outlier in the sense that how contentious the voter ID laws are in the United States. The United States, there is this history of using very technical things such as voter IDs and other literacy tests and all these other very technical details as a method of exclusion. In principle, you know, and I think this is a really tragic kind of thing because in principle, voter IDs, like if you step out of the American political debate, voter IDs are a perfectly reasonable thing, I think, to ask for. You know, you need a voter ID, you need an ID to buy alcohol, you know, asking to have a voter ID to vote doesn't seem to be that extreme. The problem is in the American context, the advocates of voter IDs are doing this for very pernicious purposes. I mean, the aim is to exclude voters who don't have IDs from voting, who disproportionately vote for Democrats. And so Republicans very much are advocates of requiring voter IDs by states. What I've always thought a kind of clever political response from Democrats would be, rather than saying we don't want voter IDs, would be to say, we want voter IDs, but established by the national government. We'll have a federal voter ID. And I think if Joe Biden today were to say, you know, I've changed my mind, I'm in favor of voter IDs, our Justice Department will produce these, send them out, we'll enforce it. What you would quickly see is that suddenly Republicans would be against voter IDs because they would realize that that would be a genuine kind of protection mechanism for voting. And if these IDs were issued immediately upon turning age 18, as happens in Germany, you know, then this would be a perfectly reasonable thing to do. But given the particular configuration of American politics, voter IDs are simply a method of exclusion. But I think it's unfortunate because it does give Republicans an issue with which to beat up Democrats over. I don't know what's been going on in Britain. I'm surprised that they have now taken this up as well. And I'm not sure if the same purposes are, if it's being used for the same purposes there.
Ben, thank you so much. We've reached the end of our event. We've covered, you have covered, our audience has covered a lot of ground from the changing supply side of democracy over containment, so to speak, strategies, containment, exclusion, competition, to questions spanning everything from voter ID to non-inclusive institution. It's been fantastic to listen to you. Also, fantastic to hear all the questions. And I think I also speak on behalf of Mark Hallerberg when I say on your next visit or longer stay in Berlin, I sincerely hope you drop by the Hertie School, you join us for a live event in person, and we really, really look forward to welcoming you in Friedrichstraße. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I really enjoyed
it. I'll clap for everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you to our communications team for setting up the event, and thanks to the audience for joining us.